If the book of James were a modern textbook, it would be called Techniques in Christianity rather than Principles of Christianity. The book emphasizes how we practice our faith rather than the theological concepts of faith. In this lesson, James speaks to those who are seeking to be considered wise, to have that kind of reputation. He asserts that if you want the reputation of being wise, then you must first live well and wise according to the principles taught by Jesus Christ, and you must walk humbly. At work or at school, we have all seen people who wanted to be recognized as the wisest, the smartest person in the room. And so they proceeded to spout out their credentials to show us their intellectual superiority or their greater experience. James asserts to be humble if you're seeking a reputation as wise. You will be judged not based upon the words that you say, but rather the works that you do. Now, we live in a different time from James, and I recognize that this advice is rather inconsistent with the social media-influenced world that we live in today. We tend to use our selfies, our resumes, our images, our looks and likes to promote our personal agenda, whether that agenda is selfless or selfish. Now, this part takes me back to a law school lesson. Character is who you are. Reputation is who people say you are. James writes that your spiritual ambition, your boastful actions, designed to self-aggrandize, twisting of the truth that gives the world a different, better opinion of you, does not actually make you wiser or better. It doesn't change your character. Yes, it may lead to a false but better reputation, but that reputation is built upon a flawed character. James is warning us to stay away from a life that tends to use earthly wisdom, street smarts, to survive. He says, even animals, because of their instinct, use cunning to survive. But using lies to promote yourself and to promote your agenda is animalistic and devilish. As we pad our resumes, take credit for things we did not do, or cheat on tests, James asserts we're just setting ourselves up for a fall. When the truth is ultimately revealed, a career, wealth, relationships built on lies fall apart and create confusion. Real heavenly wisdom comes from God and manifests itself in living a holy life, in living in harmony with others, in living a life that seeks to be gentle, reasonable, filled with mercy. Our leadership should not be focused on lording over people, but rather serving other people. You see, heavenly wisdom seeks to serve and edify. The whole community is built up. Society is built up by heavenly wisdom. People working together in peace, treating each other with respect and dignity, overcoming differences, and solving complex problems that face society. That's the result of heavenly wisdom. Though James may not have contemplated Facebook or Pinterest, LinkedIn or Instagram, he is writing to us today. We need to use the wisdom from God to pull us together and out of our crisis. As we move into the second part of our lesson, we must remember that these Christians were under pressure of being persecuted. This religion, Christianity, is a new faith. Some would even call it a cult at this point. In the church, the rich were exploiting the poor. Societal ills often creep into our religious organizations and practices. So James is now writing to a church that needs to unify and not divide. Facing oppression, these Christians were anxious for relief. So no doubt some of them were impatient, waiting for a quick return of Jesus. James is teaching how they must live together and work together as an organization of believers while they await the second coming of Christ. I remember as a kid, popping popcorn was an all-night affair. You had to heat the oil, put some test kernels in. It took about an hour or so. Now I get impatient waiting for the microwave to finish in 2 minutes and 30 seconds. So James is writing to Christians then and now, be patient. To help them understand, he makes an analogy about a farmer saying, farmers plant crops. They wait for the rain and then they wait for the crops to mature before they can harvest. James is encouraging these Christians to stay strong and be patient. Jesus will return at any time. Trying to unite these people, James tells these Christians not to complain about each other. You may have issues against them, and they may have issues that they can lodge against you, and all of this leads to division. As an example of patience, he points to Job, who patiently waited on God to pull him out of the suffering he was enduring. James reassures them and us that God cares for us, so our actions and our words must show we believe that God still cares. That's the lesson for this week. Have a great week. Bye.